Hey everyone, in this video, I'm going to be talking about the two friction force equations. But before we get into the equations themselves, I've got a little experiment set up here. I've got a block of wood with 4 1-kilogram masses sitting on it, and I've got a force sensor. I'm going to pull the block, and we're going to use that force sensor to explore a little bit about the friction that the block is experiencing. All right, so I'm attaching the sensor to the block, and let me pull on the block with, let's say, about 3 newtons of force. So I'm pulling on the block with 3 newtons of force. There's a resistive friction force that the block is experiencing, which is matching that exactly. So if I pull with 3 newtons of force, there's 3 newtons of friction resisting my pull. All right, let me pull a little bit stronger. Okay, I'm pulling with about 5 newtons of force now, and there's about 5 newtons of friction force preventing the block from sliding. Now I'm getting up to about 8 newtons of friction force. Let me click collect on here and we'll see a graph of all of this. So if I pull with 3 newtons, 5 newtons of force, 6 newtons of force, 7 newtons of force, 8 newtons, 9 newtons, 10 newtons, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 6. All right, there it started to move. Eventually, if I pull with enough force, there won't be enough friction to prevent the block from speeding up or starting to move. Let me do that again and see what happens. So I'm gonna pull. Here's 9 newtons of friction, 11 newtons, 12 newtons, 13, 14, 15. And then as I pull with a constant velocity, you notice the friction is staying about the same, somewhere around 12 newtons of friction as I pull with a constant velocity. It fluctuates a little bit there. So let me zoom in on this real quick. So here when I was pulling on, let's say, 4.12 newtons of force, there was 4.12 newtons of friction resisting that. When I was pulling a little bit harder, 10.24 newtons of force, there would have been 10.24 newtons of friction resisting that pull. Even when I got up to 16 newtons of force, 16 newtons of friction. Eventually when I got up to, let's see, about 18.5 newtons of force, the block started to slide. That was the maximum friction that the block had with the table. As soon as I had more force than that, the block started to slide. But once it was sliding, it was only producing around 12 newtons of friction while it was moving. So this maximum static friction, or the friction when the block's not moving, was greater than the kinetic or sliding friction, or the friction that it was experiencing while the block was moving. That was only around 12 newtons or so. If I didn't reach that 18.5 or so newtons of force that I was pulling with, and the block was stationary, the friction could be any value from 0 all the way up to that 18.5 or so newtons of force. And that's what the two friction force equations are trying to tell us. So let's jump to those equations on the whiteboard and relate those equations to the experiment that we just did here. So let's start with the static friction equation. So the force of static friction, or F sub F static, and that's static just means that it's not moving yet. So this is when we're pulling on the block, but it's not yet moving. It's less than or equal to, well, all of that. So let's break down those two variables real quick. This symbol right here that looks kind of like a U with a little tail, or maybe like an M, but the middle part is a little bit more round, that's called a mu. It's the Greek letter mu, and that's the coefficient of friction. Now that coefficient of friction, or mu, is a property of the two surfaces that are in contact with each other. So if I'm using two surfaces that are very slick against each other, like metal on the table here, there's gonna be a low coefficient of friction. They're gonna slide across each other really easily. However, if I use, like, let's say sandpaper on the table, that's gonna have a big coefficient of friction. It's not gonna wanna slide across the table very easily. Or if you've got a computer and it's got little like rubber feet on it, those rubber feet help prevent it from sliding. Well, rubber on the table has a higher coefficient of friction than just the normal surface of your computer would. So that mu, the coefficient of friction, depends on the two surfaces. And in fact, you can go online and look those values up. My favorite place to look them up is engineeringtoolbox.com, the sponsor of this video. Just kidding, no sponsors in this video. But it is my favorite place to look these up. It's got a whole table of a whole bunch of values of coefficient of frictions between different surfaces and different conditions. So an engineer would go to a table like this whenever they're trying to figure out, like, okay, is this surface gonna have too much or too little traction against some other surface? And in general, the coefficient of friction, the higher it is, means the more resistance that there's gonna be between the two surfaces. So big coefficient of friction, a lot of resistance, a lot of friction. Smaller coefficient of friction, the two surfaces will slide across each other more easily. And that next variable is the normal force. So in other words, the greater the normal force between two objects, the more friction there's gonna be between them. And you could use your hands as an example of this. If you just push your hands together with a little bit of normal force, they slide very easily across each other. But if you push really hard, then it's harder to slide because you're increasing the normal force and therefore there's more friction between your hands. Also, I can show you an example of that if we jump back to our experiment real quick. So I got my four masses on the block. I'm gonna pull the block. As I pull it, I'm gonna remove those four masses. Each time I remove a mass, I'm decreasing the normal force between the block and the table. So we'll see the effect of that decreased normal force as I remove the blocks on the amount of friction that's resisting my pull. So let me hit collect there. All right, we got the block moving at a constant speed. Remove a block. Notice how the amount of friction has gone down. Remove another mass. Amount of friction has gone down. Remove another mass. A lot less friction. The last mass, the friction's very small. So we were decreasing the normal force between the block and the table, and every time we decreased that normal force, the amount of friction decreased as well. Now coming back to our equation here, you'll notice that the force of static friction is less than or equal to the product of those two variables. And we saw that in the beginning of the video as we were pulling. That static friction could be anywhere from 0 up to, I think it was 18.5 newtons, but 18.5 newtons was the maximum static friction. Or in other words, the force of static friction had to be less than or equal to, and then this side would be the 18.5. Now let's do the kinetic or sliding friction equation. The force of kinetic friction, and remember, kinetic or sliding just means that the two surfaces are actually moving, not just held still like in static friction. That force of kinetic friction equals mu k times the normal force. Now notice it's basically the same equation. This one's an inequality because if it's not moving, the friction could be less than or equal to that amount. And in the kinetic friction, it's always going to be equal to that amount. Now in this case, I have a K there for the mu kinetic, and this is S for the mu static. So depending on if the objects are moving or not moving, you're going to have a different coefficient of friction. In a given problem, make sure you're using the correct coefficient of friction, whether the object is stationary or static, or if it's moving, kinetic. All right, let's go through an example similar to what I did in the experiment at the beginning to help us understand and apply these two equations a little bit better. So let's start with this. The block shown below is being pulled to the right. The block, including the mass on top of the block, weighs 21.8 newtons. The coefficient of maximum static friction is 0.275, and the coefficient of kinetic friction is 0.230. Notice that the kinetic friction coefficient is smaller than the static friction coefficient. To relate that back to experiment earlier, remember it took 18.5 newtons to get it started. That would have correlated with the static friction coefficient. But once it was moving, there was only about 12 newtons of friction. And that corresponds with this kinetic friction coefficient being smaller. Before we do anything else, let's draw our free body diagram. We've got force of gravity downward and a normal force upward, and those two are going to be equal to each other because the block has a constant vertical motion, or it's not moving vertical at all. Those are balanced. And then we've got a tension force to the right and a friction force to the left. And assuming we're pulling at a constant speed, or if the block isn't moving at all yet, those two forces will be balanced and equal to each other in magnitude. So let's calculate the maximum static friction. We'll start by writing our static friction inequality here. It's less than or equal to mu s times the normal force. Now I got to make sure I use the correct coefficient of friction. I'm looking at static friction right now, so I'm going to use that 0.275 times the normal force. Well, it doesn't tell me the normal force, it tells me the weight, so I know the force of gravity is 21.8. Well, that is equivalent to the normal force, so the normal force must also be 21.8 newtons. So our force of static friction is less than or equal to 6 newtons. When I multiply those two together, I get 6 newtons. Now that doesn't mean that we have 6 newtons of static friction no matter what. The static friction could be anywhere from 0 up to 6. 6 newtons is the most that I could pull before it would start moving. If I pull with 6.01 newtons, the block's going to start to move. Now let's calculate our kinetic or sliding friction. Same deal, we're going to write our kinetic friction equation right there. And this time, instead of using mu sub s, we're going to use mu sub k. Our coefficient of kinetic friction is 0.230 times our normal force, which is still 21.8, and I get our kinetic friction force of 5 newtons. Now let's look at some scenarios as we pull harder and harder on the block and think about what would happen in each of these. So I just rewrote what we knew already here. Our max static friction is 6 newtons, and our kinetic friction is 5 newtons. So what happens if we pull with 3 newtons of force? Well, if we're pulling with 3 newtons of force, so we've got a tension force of 3 newtons, that is less than our maximum static friction, so the block's not going to be moving yet. Our friction force would balance that out exactly. We'd have 3 newtons of friction force, and the block would remain stationary. All right, what if we pulled a little bit harder? In this case, we're pulling with 5 newtons of force. Well, again, the block hasn't started moving yet. We have to compare that number with our maximum static friction. So I'm pulling with 5 newtons. 5 newtons is still less than the 6 newtons, so I haven't reached the maximum static friction. This number isn't really relevant yet because the block hasn't started moving, so I'm not worried about this at all yet. So our friction, our static friction, balances out our pull exactly. It's going to be 5 newtons, and our block is still going to be stationary. All right, let's pull a little bit harder. What happens if we pull with 6 newtons of force? So our tension would be 6 newtons. Now that is equal to 6 newtons over here. So if we're pulling at exactly 6 newtons, then we're okay. There can be 6 newtons of static friction. But we've reached the point where if we pull any harder at all, the block is going to start moving. If we pull with 6.01 newtons, that block is going to start moving. Now, once it does start moving, there will no longer be 6 newtons of friction force. As soon as it starts moving, it's going to jump down to only having 5 newtons of friction force. That's why when you start to pull something like pulling the block, it kind of jerks a little bit because it takes more force to get it started than it does to keep it going at a constant speed. Let's look at that final example. Once the block is moving, how much force is needed to keep the speed constant? Well, if it's moving, we just said there would be 5 newtons of kinetic friction. So to balance that out, then we would need to be pulling with 5 newtons of force. So once it's moving, we have to pull with 5 newtons of force to keep its speed constant. So again, we went through the two types of friction. We had static friction, and that equation is going to tell us what's the maximum amount of friction we could have before something starts moving. And then the kinetic friction tells us what is the friction that the object experiences as it is moving. Both those equations are very similar. They both have mu, which is a coefficient of friction. That's a property of the two surfaces rubbing against each other. So as long as the two surfaces are the same, they're going to have approximately the same coefficient of friction. The other variable that affects the friction is the contact force between the two surfaces, or the normal force. The greater the contact force between two surfaces, the greater the friction is going to be. And if you know those two variables, mu and normal force, you can calculate either the kinetic friction or the maximum static friction. Okay, quick physics fun fact. If you've got something that's rolling, you might think that was kinetic friction because it's moving. Technically, that's static friction. Because think about it. If you've got an object like this and it's rolling, there's no sliding happening. So the substances aren't actually sliding past each other. So it's actually static friction.